the crossing analyses of the IT industry and international relations. Welcome to the Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. I'm Rocky Uriankai. Today is the last episode of season two, which is also the last episode of this year. Here, I'd like to wish everyone an early Happy New Year. Today, we'll be talking about something special, an important factor that affects the US-China tech war. We've discussed this something several times before, and it's photolithography, or optical lithography, machines. I'll be giving away the answer up front. China's Huawei has already been researching lithography machines. If SME, which has claimed that it would be launching a 28-nanometer lithography machine in late 2021, early 2022, doesn't pick up the pace soon, the title of first Chinese company to self-develop a high-end lithography machine will be going to Huawei instead. In fact, in the episode that was uploaded on December 1st, 3 weeks ago, I already hinted that SME was not the only company developing lithography machines within China. However, for some reasons that you can maybe guess, I couldn't say so explicitly at that time. Today, I can reveal a bit more, mainly because on December 1st, Bloomberg published a report that disclosed this piece of information that I had previously kept secret. Although the main headline of the article doesn't say so, if you read the content of the article carefully, you will know that Huawei is developing a lithography machine. It's titled, China Secretly Transforms Huawei into Most Powerful Chip War Weapon. Maybe it's because this title wasn't very attractive. Or maybe it's because Bloomberg is a premium media, so not very many people saw this article. Or maybe it's because it was published on a Saturday, December 2nd, in Taiwanese time. Regardless, only one Taiwanese media outlet excerpted a small part of the story, and it didn't really talk about its significance. So, today, I'm going to use the content of this report as a basis to talk about a different focus. However, before we get to the main topic, a quick ad segment. The IT industry is changing rapidly. How can we grasp the most accurate and important information in the shortest time? DIGITIMES is the world's most professional Chinese IT industry newspaper. DIGITIMES has launched the mobile version of DIGITIMES to help readers acquire first-hand industry information anytime and anywhere. Check out the video description below for more information about the mobile version of DIGITIMES. Okay, back to the main topic. What is the main focus of Bloomberg's report? Let's start by looking at an illustration from the report. Although Bloomberg is a paid service, another media outlet has already reposted this image. The diamond-shaped black block on the left represents Shenzhen Major Industry Investment Group. The Bloomberg report emphasized that it was established in 2019. Its purpose is to support the chip industry and Huawei with national capital. The diamond-shaped black block on the right represents Huawei. Now, let's focus on the three dark green rectangular blocks in the top middle. From top to bottom, these represent three semiconductor-related companies in Shenzhen, PXW, Suishou, and PST. These are all new companies that were only established in 2021 or 2022. Through this image, Bloomberg's report suggested that all three companies are part of Huawei's transformation into a complete semiconductor supply chain. The only difference is that they don't carry the Huawei label, so outsiders have no idea that they are closely related to Huawei. Below, there are two companies not connected to Huawei, indicating that they were established by the Shenzhen Major Industry Investment Group, but have not yet developed a direct relationship with Huawei, so let's not dwell on them for now. The most crucial part of this image is the orange block at the bottom. It represents Si carrier, and the Si here is clearly referring to silicon. We can see from the image that Si carrier has three subsidiaries: Cornerstone, which is dedicated to photoresist R&D ZTOP, which operates optical machines, and Yue Ascend, which operates chip equipment. It's pronounced Yue Ascend, a reference to Huawei's Ascend chips. It is explicitly mentioned on the right that Huawei and Sicaria have exchanged both staff and patents. This includes a significant number of researchers from Huawei who are responsible for the R&D of the lithography machines, who have either already moved to or are on their way to working for this new company. Bloomberg's report also mentions a mysterious 2012 team within Huawei, which is the main unit that interacts with Sicaria. The code name 2012, was chosen personally by Huawei founder Ren Zhengfei after watching the Hollywood disaster movie 2012. Have you seen that movie? In it, Earth faced a series of world-ending disasters, and only a small portion of humanity was saved. Saved by whom? By a massive rescue ship built by China. I wonder what Ren Zhengfei is thinking. It's worth mentioning that Bloomberg's report also answered a question that has been hotly debated on my personal Facebook page, which is whether Huawei is a state-owned, state-funded company or not. This Bloomberg report answered this question that Huawei does not want direct capital injection from the state. Hence, it established these independent companies outside of the group to each develop different aspects of the semiconductor supply chain. We can say that Huawei is willing to accept cooperation with state-owned enterprises, headlined by Shenzhen, but it's not willing to receive their investment. This indirectly proves that Huawei, which is not publicly listed, is not considered a Chinese state-owned company. Some have told me that this is one of the reasons why Huawei can maintain its innovative capability, implying that state-owned enterprises are less innovative. What do you think? Going back to SiCarrier, the small group with three subsidiaries, the Bloomberg report explained that its main business includes conducting R&D for chip manufacturing equipment. One of the pieces of evidence described in the report is an evacuation map hanging on the wall, making it sound like the information came from a spy who infiltrated SiCarrier's offices and saw it in person. To be honest, I had my doubts when I first read the entire report. Bloomberg stated that it got the information from an anonymous source. Who is this anonymous source? Could this exclusive information be intentionally leaked by US intelligence agencies? Don't think this is ridiculous. In intelligence terms, this is called detection deterrence. By informing your opponent or enemy that I know what you're up to, it acts as a warning for them to not take reckless actions or compel them to take on more costs by increasing security. Otherwise, how is Bloomberg, and sometimes Reuters, able to consistently produce reports related to internal secrets of Huawei for the past several months? Of course, we can attribute some of this to the journalists' outstanding skills in collecting, analyzing, and researching this information. Despite that, there is some information that clearly came from internal sources, making it hard to believe that the journalists established these connections all by themselves. Of course, Bloomberg also approached Huawei and Shenzhen Major Industry Investment Group. They either denied or did not respond to anything stated in the report. We can understand this kind of secretive attitude. In fact, Huawei has consistently refrained from responding to various reports and speculations about the technical details of the Mate 60, neither confirming nor denying, and allowing everyone to make their guesses. I analyzed the intricacies of this approach in the episode that was uploaded on October 3rd. Interested viewers can go and check out that episode. Before I wrap things up, I'd like to share my thoughts on this Bloomberg report. My main issue is that I don't agree with the decision to describe Huawei as a weapon in the US-China chip war. Huawei is a company, and Ren Zhengfei is an outstanding entrepreneur. When he founded Huawei back in 1987, his purpose wasn't to serve the Chinese Communist government. Interestingly, 1987 was also the year TSMC was founded, a curious coincidence. Moreover, a company has its own goals and path of growth. It's not an inanimate object, so labeling it as a weapon is just not very appropriate. It's ignoring the agency behind this company. Furthermore, according to the export sanctions issued by the USBIS on October 17th, which is a supplement to the flawed export sanction issued on October 7th of last year, it explicitly stated that what the US is concerned about is China obtaining advanced chips to develop powerful AI for military and national defense modernization. Yet Huawei's Mate 60 smartphone, which began its online sales on August 29 this year, featured a self-developed and self-produced Kirin 9000S chip, a high computing power chip. This showed that China may no longer need to rely on US companies like Nvidia for so-called AI chips when developing its AI. Doesn't this mean that the US might have difficulty effectively restricting the modernization of the People's Liberation Army? This could be a major issue. Regarding Huawei's potential breakthrough in computing power chips, I hinted at it in the episode uploaded on October 20th by analyzing Meng Wanzhou's speech. As expected, news surfaced on November 21st about Huawei selling 1,600 AI chips to Baidu. Computing Power is National Power. That was the title of the November 17 episode. Today, it seems like I'm also reviewing what I've done in the past 6 months. In conclusion, the US government's current tech war against China primarily focuses on semiconductors and AI. If China cannot consistently improve the quality and quantity of its domestically produced chips, it may struggle to enhance its military and overall national power due to US sanctions. On the other hand, from the US perspective, if it cannot constantly maintain a lead in wafer manufacturing and production capacity over China by at least 5 years or more, it might find the gap in military and overall national strength narrowing due to China's expertise in manufacturing. In that case, national security would be less assured. Therefore, lithography machines are indeed a critical equipment that can trigger a chain reaction. That's it for today's episode of Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. Thank you for watching. Also, I'd like to thank you for your continued support and interest in IT industry and international relations topics. In the future, I will continue to share my research on these topics. I'm Rocky Oriankai. Hope to see you again on YouTube soon.